If everyone could find a seat, the appointed time has arrived. It is 9 o'clock. Today is Friday, September 30th. I'd like to call the meeting of the Delta Stewardship Council to order and welcome everybody that is here with us in the second floor conference room of the Park Tower building at 980 9th Street in Sacramento. I'm into this hearing officer mode. I kind of like all the details. We'll begin with the roll call. It looks like it's we have a just-in-time arrival.
Tatian here.
Fiorini here.
PIFO here.
We have a quorum. I almost asked if there was any request for public comment. Man, I need a cup of coffee, I guess. Okay, on to file item number 15, laying the foundation for the proposed ecosystem amendment to the Delta Plan. Jessica?
Well, it's my pleasure and also my sadness to introduce for the last time Jessica Davenport leading a panel here, and I think I'm just gonna turn it over to her, but not without saying how much I've appreciated her contribution to the Delta Plan and the implementation of the Delta Plan, and that I'm just really pleased that she'll continue to be working on Bay Delta issues.
Thank you very much, Jessica. So before I begin, since this is my last council meeting, I'd just like to take a moment to thank Chair Fiorini and the rest of the council members. Really enjoyed working with all of you over the last 4 years. It's been an honor and a privilege, so thank you for that. And I'd also like to thank all the great colleagues that I've gotten to work with, both the council staff as well as all our colleagues at the other agencies and stakeholder groups. It's just been a fantastic experience to get to collaborate with so many great people working to achieve the council's mission. So now on to the matter at hand.
This puts us at a Jessica deficit. Now we'll only be down to two. So any Jessicas out there watching or in the audience, feel free to apply.
So when the council approved the 2013 Delta Plan, you adopted policies and recommendations to restore aquatic habitat and improve water quality while respecting local land uses and expanding opportunities for nature-based recreation and tourism. However, to avoid duplication, the Delta Plan did not include all of the conservation measures that were in the draft Bay Delta Conservation Plan, which was at that time thought that it could be incorporated into the Delta Plan. So in May 2015, when the Department of Water Resources and the U.S. Bureau of Reclamation decided not to pursue the BDCP as an integrated approach to water conveyance and ecosystem conservation in the Delta, you made a commitment to revisit the Delta Plan and assess the need for an ecosystem restoration amendment, and then, of course, the conveyance, storage, and operations amendment that has already been started as being under consideration, which is separate from this. So in June of this year, the Department of Fish and Wildlife announced its intent to develop a Delta conservation framework that will include new implementation and policy guidance. So as my colleagues will soon tell you more about, this Delta conservation framework will address elements of the Bay Delta Conservation Plan that were not included in the EcoRestore initiative, but they will continue on the work of EcoRestore, which has been very successful. And this conservation framework will also guide an ecosystem restoration amendment to the Delta Plan, and it will also guide grant making by the Department of Fish and Wildlife and others. It has a dual focus on ecosystem function and Delta community benefits. The Department of Fish and Wildlife has also funded the San Francisco Estuary Institute to produce a Delta Renewed. The third in a series of reports that has included SFAI's Delta Historical Ecology Report and the Delta Landscape Metrics Report. So these efforts can lay a very strong foundation for a Delta Plan ecosystem restoration amendment that will more comprehensively address the conservation of terrestrial, transitional, and aquatic habitats, as well as their integration at the landscape scale. It can improve local acceptance of conservation efforts and facilitate project permitting. It can also provide recommendations regarding adaptation to climate change. So the council staff intends to rely on guidance from these two efforts, along with lessons learned from the first 3 years of the Delta Plan's implementation, to inform the development of a proposed Delta Plan ecosystem restoration amendment. So now I'd like to introduce our panelists, and I will introduce all of them at once, so then they can just flow from one presentation to the next. So to my right is Dr. Letitia Grenier. She co-directs San Francisco Estuary Institute's Resilient Landscapes Program. She's the science lead for the 2015 State of the Estuary Report and the 2015 update to the Baylands Ecosystem Habitat Goals, heading a team of over 200 environmental scientists, managers, and regulators to develop science-based recommendations for restoring and maintaining the health of the bay's tidal wetlands in the face of rising sea levels and other stressors. She holds a PhD in conservation biology from UC Berkeley. To her right is Dr. Brooke Jacobs, senior environmental scientist in the water branch at the Department of Fish and Wildlife. She supervises senior staff in the department's involvement, leading the department's involvement in several Delta programs. These are, in addition to the Delta Conservation Framework, she also supervises staff working on California Water Fix and the Water Storage Investment Program. And I just learned recently that she's worked on all three of those programs and is very impressed. She, prior to working there, she obtained a master's and a PhD in population biology from the University of California, Davis. And finally, to Brooke's right is Dr. Christina Sloop, also senior environmental scientist in the water branch at CDFW. And she recently joined the team, but before that, for over 25 years, she's worked in the fields of ecology and natural resource conservation across Northern California and North America's Central and Pacific flyways. Her scientific expertise includes conservation science, wetland ecology, climate adaptation, and population genetics. And she joined the department in January to lead the Delta Conservation Framework planning effort. She received her PhD in ecology from UC Davis and master's in conservation biology from San Francisco State University. So I'll now hand it over to my distinguished colleagues.
All right, I think I'm gonna start us off. I'm gonna remember to turn on the mic. And what I'm going to tell you about is the science that we've been doing for almost a decade, trying to understand how the Delta used to work historically, how it works now, and how it could work better in the future to do the kinds of things that we would like it to do, like supporting native wildlife, having a robust food web, things like that. And I wanted to remind you that in 2012, so about 4 years ago, my colleagues who wrote the historical ecology report came and presented to you about it. So I'm gonna glide over that very quickly. In the interim in 2014, if you look at that middle map, we looked at how the Delta works now, and we tried to understand the transformation of that historical landscape on the left to the current landscape in the middle. So I'll be telling you a little bit about that report, because the fundamental transformation of the Delta, it really informs what we can do in the future to transform it again. And that's the report that we're coming out with in about a month. It's called A Delta Renewed, and that Jessica referred to. So if you can't read the words, don't worry about it. What these are quotes from some really important documents backing up the foundation of how we approached this science, and that was to look at very large-scale, holistic, long-term, system-based restoration of the Delta. So this is not a plan for restoring one species or one place. This is a plan for restoring the entire system. And that's in some ways, that's very different than a lot of what's required in the past in a regulatory way. So that science isn't out there yet. And that's why the department hired us to try to come up with this approach. And we were able to do it somewhat independently without a lot of political pressure. And I think that's one of the strengths of our series of reports. So a quick reminder about what this place used to look like in the Delta. It was basically one big wetland with several rivers flowing through it. It was really actually a lot of deltas that poured into one place. And here's that same view of the Sacramento River now. So just a really quick overview that we have radically transformed this place almost 100%. The way that we've approached this work has always been to have this sort of all-star team of scientists reviewing and giving input on our work. So we feel that we've been able to have the most up-to-date and best available science because we're drawing on a lot of local and national expertise. And we call them our landscape interpretation team since all of our work was based on landscape science. And so to get at this holistic, long-time view, large spatial scale approach, the first thing we said to ourselves is, what do people want the Delta to do ecologically that it's not doing now? And so we came up with what we call ecological functions, and that's the band in yellow. And those are eight things. Five of them are about supporting different groups of wildlife. We want the Delta to support native fish. We want the Delta to support marsh wildlife. We want the Delta to support riparian wildlife that lives along streams. But then we went beyond that sort of taxonomic approach and said we also want to have a robust food web. We want the whole system to work. We want our populations to be able to evolve with natural selection, or no matter how big their habitats are, they're not going to be able to face climate change. So we took a sort of deep technical ecological approach to structure the work, and then we made a lot of measurements of how the landscape changed that would affect these desired functions. That's what all the pink boxes are. And you'll see as I go through what I mean in more detail. So here again, we're looking at that change from historical to modern. These are two different habitat maps. And you can see just by looking at the colors, that change from blue to pink, which is also emphasized in the bar graph, what's happened. And I explained this to my four-year-old a year ago, and he said, oh, I get it, Mommy. We've taken food for wildlife and turned it into food for people. And that's exactly what happened. There was a big wetland here. It fed wildlife. And now we've got a big, really productive agricultural area. And so at the most basic level, that's been the transformation. But there's a lot of complexity to it that I want to tell you guys a little bit more about. So one of the really big process-based changes, and I'm going to talk a lot about processes because processes are what underlie this system and make it work. And when I say that, I mean things like flows, flooding, delivery of sediment, those big physical processes on the land surface that create and maintain ecosystems and habitats. And so here you're looking at a map of different kinds of flooding that happened in the historical delta. That dark purpley blue in the north and south is basin flooding. It's long-term, several months, several feet deep. These were basically massively productive floodplains. They were there for several months of the year. They actually occurred at different times in the north and south, and they fed fish, they fed bears, they fed everything that could come, birds, everything that could come and take advantage of it. In the middle, that medium blue is all the tidal flooding. So that was flooding almost every day. And so that was a place where there were productive wetlands year-round. And then around the periphery, you see a light blue, and those were seasonally flooded, kind of intermittent wetlands, wet meadows, flooding off and on in a complicated pattern. And you'll notice that that really dark blue of the channels, there's not that much of it. There wasn't that much water, perennial water, all the time in the delta. And it was mostly moving. There weren't a lot of lakes. So historically, what you can see is a really complex pattern, different kinds of flooding, different places, different times of year. And that was the refrigerator of California. That made food. And so all the wildlife that could get here would come here to eat. And when they did, they had different options. So if it was a hot year or a dry year or a cool year or it was April or it was September, there was somewhere to go and there would always be food in the delta and cover. Here's what our inundation map looks like now. There's actually more of that very dark blue perennial lake-like water. So those are kind of novel places that our species weren't adapted to. There's none of that deep basin flooding, essentially. There's almost no tidal flooding. We know there's a couple marshes, about 1% to 2% of what there used to be. And then there's a little bit of that light blue, sort of short-term seasonal flooding. You see a lot of it in the Yolo Bypass in the north, and there's a little bit in the Cosumnes. I don't know if you guys can see this. If I do it, probably not.
Sorry to interrupt, but you should have copies of the slides from yesterday in your packet.
Okay, thanks. So there's a little bit on the Cosumnes River, if you know where that is. And those are actually our two really great examples of success. So where we've made these floodplains, even though they somewhat pale in comparison to the historical function that used to be there, they're working, right? The Yolo Bypass is a success. The Cosumnes River restoration is a success. So just to say that even though we've radically transformed the system, even when we transform small pieces of it back, we see a lot of response. And we know that fish that grow on the floodplain become very fat. They call them floodplain fatties. And then our channel fish tend to be relatively small. And so I decided to call them river runts. I was trying to come up with some alliteration for you. Okay, quickly looking at marshes, because we already talked about this. If you look at the change in green, that's the 98% loss of tidal marsh, about 99% loss if you include all the different kinds of marsh. So no surprise that things are hard here for species that evolved to live in a totally different place than what we have now. Now let's think a little bit more carefully about what's happened to the channels, because this is kind of complicated. You still see a lot of channels in the Delta, but they're not the same as what was here historically. So you can see that these are very dendritic networks. They're a lot like the blood system in your body. So there were all these big channels, kind of like arteries, that went into little channels like capillaries. And these fed the marsh and took away waste products, just like the capillaries do in your body. Here's the channels now. So see, the gray is now. And what you can realize is that almost all the capillaries are gone. And so by taking out the wetlands, we've kind of starved the landscape of that exchange of materials and energy and biota that made the system work. In addition, we've added a lot of cross-channel cuts, and those have allowed the water to move faster and in different directions. And if you can imagine that someone did this to your circulatory system, you wouldn't be feeling very well either. So I hope these analogies help us to kind of understand in a really basic way the transformation that's occurred. As we were producing that report on Delta transformation, we were also really coming up with how do we think scientifically about resilience of a landscape? We've got climate change, we've got pressure on water supply, we've got growing human population size. We went to the entire world literature and said, what are the things that we can do to make landscapes resilient? And we were lucky enough to produce this report, which is now becoming a peer-reviewed manuscript, with some of the experts on resilient science from around the world. So, this is really a coalescing of some pretty esoteric ecology literature, and the idea was to make it operational for people who are actually doing restoration. And so we came up with these principles. I'm happy to share this with you. It's a short, quick read about what you should do on the ground to make a whole landscape work better in the face of perturbations and long-term change like sea level rise. And so there are principles like think about the setting, restore your fundamental physical processes, make sure you have the appropriate levels of connectivity. Shoot for diversity and complexity. You need redundancy, which is kind of interesting, so you need to hedge your bets if you lose a population or a patch. Make sure you're operating at the right scale, often a huge challenge for us in restoration to do things big enough and long-term enough. And then remember that people are the critical key here, both for making decisions, and in the Delta, people live here, and there are many ecosystem services this landscape has to continue to provide. So that led us to this really basic conceptual model that I want to share with you about how we think about landscape resilience. So are these physical processes that I just talked about, like flooding and flows and sediment supply, and those create and maintain a landscape. And the interaction of those processes with the landscape determines what you get out in terms of ecological functions. And these are things like supporting native wildlife, a robust food web. They can include other ecosystem services like water supply, water quality. This is basically how our ecosystems work. And this, let's pretend this is the historical ecosystem. It was pretty intact. Everything used to work. And then we decided to make some changes. And so we interrupted a lot of the physical processes of flooding and flows and sediment delivery. We took away a lot of the elements of the landscape, of the natural system, and fragmented. We added some new elements. And now we're not getting out all of those historical ecological functions, which is what we're trying to restore. So how can we deal with this? And our approach is to put back some of the physical processes strategically. It's not a return to historical conditions. It's a scientific approach to thinking at the landscape scale, what do we need where? Then we need to restore some landscape elements. We need bigger habitat patches. They need to be connected. All of those principles I was saying from our landscape resilience framework. And if you do that, you're going to get back ecological function. It's not going to be like historical function, but you can get back all the things you need to maintain the species or functions you're interested in. So that's the idea. Here's a quick look at the report that's coming out. So we have our functions that I showed you in that graph with the yellow boxes and the pink boxes. And this one, for example, is how do you support marsh wildlife? And we give you this conceptual map. We're very carefully not saying do this on this parcel, but we are saying make these kinds of habitats and processes come back in these kinds and parts of the Delta. Here's kind of the configuration and the scale and the size of what you should be thinking about doing. Here's what should be next to other things. And we've kind of overemphasized the extent of restoration here just so you can see all the little bits on the map. And then we know that if you're going to look at, if you're going to actually design a project, you need a smaller scale idea of what to do. So let's say you're interested in returning marsh wildlife to part of the Delta. Well, how would you actually do it at in a real place? And so then we have these conceptual maps of different strategies that you would bring together in an integrated way to restore that marsh wildlife function in one place. So for example, these are all based on returning those physical processes that we talked about. So they are things like reestablish tidal processes at the right elevations, reestablish fluvial processes at the fluvial-tidal interface. So they're kind of technical ideas, and here we try to make them very clear about how you would piece it together, wildlife-friendly agriculture, subsidence reversal, it's those kind of strategies. And we have maps like this for each of our functions. And then we have a lot of detail about those strategies so that project designers and managers can really get into all of the data that we looked at to think about what they want to do where. For example, this is the strategy of restoring tidal processes at intertidal elevations. And so this map, all the colors of green are about where the appropriate elevations are to restore tidal marsh, looking both at what's intertidal now and what will be intertidal with up to 2 meters of sea level rise. So this is all looking forward for long timescales. And you can see that we call out on that map different parts of the Delta and try to say, like, well, here's a place with a lot of public land. Maybe this, and it has the right elevation. So this is a good place to be thinking about doing this kind of thing. And this is repeated for 9 different strategies. And then we know that people who design projects want numbers. Well, how big should it be? How far apart? What shape should it be? And as scientists, we can't tell you how many fish you want or how many tidal marsh birds you want. That's a societal choice. But we can tell you if you make things a certain size, what are you likely to get? And so that's what we try to do in this section with the targets. So the recommendation here is marshes should be as large as possible if you want to get back marsh wildlife. That's pretty clear. But then what does that mean? How big is big? And so we look at, okay, well, if you make a 2-hectare marsh, you might get a black rail. It's a cute little black marsh bird. If you have a 100-hectare marsh, you might get a really good, dense population of black rails. So now you're starting to see more function coming out of that patch. If you have a 500-acre marsh, then it's big enough to restore the tidal processes that create those dendritic networks that are like arteries that we talked about. So there you're starting to get a systems approach. Okay, if I make a marsh that big, I can set up a system that's going to be self-sustaining and work on its own. Now, is that like restoring to historical? No, because the historical average patch size was 9 times bigger, 4,500 hectares. And the largest marsh patch size historically was 110,000 hectares. So we're not talking about restoring to historical. We're trying to give guidelines to get that function back. I just want to make that clear because people are always confused about that. So in conclusion, I just want to remind us that here we are in this beautiful place that has incredible ecosystem services and values because it was a wetland, and wetlands give us so much of that. We've been making good use of it for different things for people and trying to conserve it for wildlife as well. And there is a future option. If we think big, we're willing to work online large timescales and think about the full system and not just one species at a time, where we can integrate the functions we want back from this landscape in a working landscape that gives us water, that gives us agriculture, that gives us a special place for the people who live here to still feel like they're living in the Delta. And I want to thank all of our funders and the scientists that worked on this project. Thanks.
Great report. Thank you. Jessica, do you want to take questions at the end of each presentation or wait till the 3 are completed?
If you want to do any clarifying questions for Leticia before we go into Brooke's, but I think once you hear Brooke and Christina's presentation, it'll kind of come together and maybe it'll be the discussion will be more informed.
Okay. I don't see any. So let's proceed. Thank you.
So thank you for having us here today. We're here to talk to you about the Delta Conservation Framework, which is an initiative started by the department a little bit more than a year ago when the pivot occurred from the BDCP to WaterFix and EcoRestore. CDFW committed to developing a plan to pick up what was left off the table from conservation measures 2 through 22 when that pivot happened. And we committed to do this on a very tight time frame, with completion in very early 2017. And we committed to producing a very concise, high-level document, approximately 50 pages. So fast forward to January, we were fortunate enough to be able to hire Christina Sloop as the lead staff on this project that we're now calling the Delta Conservation Framework. So right away, Christina dove into the very complex world of existing and pre-existing conservation plans in the Delta. She did a fantastic job wrapping her head around all of that. And throughout this process, we started off very early having good, close coordination with other state and local entities with a vested interest in the Delta. So we have a planning team with representatives from the Delta Stewardship Council, the Delta Science Program, Delta Conservancy, DWR, the Natural Resources Agency, and Eco Restore, and local entities as well, representing local counties. And so I think what makes this framework novel and so exciting is that we have the ability to pull on the great scientific work that SFEI is doing, but also from the beginning, having this focus on really soliciting and incorporating public feedback on our ideas as we develop the document. And so we've developed a very aggressive stakeholder outreach schedule, which Christina will mention now, and she'll tell you a little bit more about the details of what's currently in the framework as it's being developed.
Good morning. And thank you, Brooke, for the introduction and context that I will be presenting to you in the next 10 or so minutes. It's a real pleasure to be able to be here today to update you on the progress that we've been making in the development of the Delta Conservation Framework. And it is especially wonderful to, have been able to have the opportunity to learn more about the Delta and really dive in. And I feel the timing is perfect right now, where everything, the stars seem to be aligning with this report that we just heard about from Letitia coming out. And we are really, working with them very closely, and much of what I will be telling you is based on that scientific work. And of course, all the other tremendous amount of information and hard work that has been done in the last 20 plus years for the conservation of the Delta. So what we're envisioning with the Delta Conservation Framework is to provide a long-term framework. So EcoRestore, as you're well aware, has been taking off right after the pivot away from BDCP, and has made strides in actually implementing very much needed Delta restoration work. What we're trying to do is take off from that with the guidance of these other sources of information. And we call it here long term. Initially we said 25 years, but then our stakeholder outreach basically told us that maybe that's not quite enough. Maybe we need to do it a little longer, but at least have in mind the longer term as well, because of the importance of thinking ahead and thinking what changes with regard to climate change, for example, will do to the Delta. And it's always prudent to think ahead and be as prepared as we can. All right, so Brooke mentioned that we have undergone a very aggressive schedule for stakeholder outreach. We've been working from the beginning with our early planning partners, and then we've started to initiate workshops. There's a total of 4 workshops. We have so far completed 2. The first one was really basically focused on the why. Why are we doing this? And where do we want to go with this? Set a vision for it with everyone together, not the agency coming in and telling the Delta communities, this is what we're going to do, but basically saying, this is our idea, what do you think? And so I'm going to share with you in the next few slides what the early outcome of those discussions are, and keep in mind that this is still in draft, but so far, this is where we are at. So the vision that we and the stakeholders have pulled together for the future Delta is as follows. A mosaic of towns, agricultural landscapes, managed wetlands, and resilient ecosystems where people prosper and healthy fish, wildlife, and plant communities thrive. So it's, again, a combination of not just the ecosystems on one side and the people on the other. We're trying to bring it all together. So why are we doing the framework? Again, we would like to provide the Delta community with a shared vision and overarching goals and strategies that are coming out of those goals for implementation for, you know, the conservation of the Delta. It is right now providing a forum of collaborative engagement, and we hope to get broad buy-in from that. And as we move forward into the implementation stage, stakeholder involvement and feedback has been such that we think that maybe a forum like this should be ongoing. It is the long-term extension of California EcoRestore, as I mentioned previously. And in so doing, we are really, you know, having an opportunity here to look at the potential solutions for many of the recognized challenges that we face in the Delta. So it is also a high-level framework. So that means it's in a way the water action plan for Delta conservation. What we're envisioning is for it to, you know, come up with high-level goals and strategies that then can be implemented in the context of regional conservation strategies that are either already being implemented, such as the Suisun Marsh Plan, for example, and, you know, can be informed by the strategy into the future, or, you know, the great work that's going on in the Yolo Bypass, we can, you know, help with further focus on that in the long term. And there are several new regional efforts that are being pulled together at the moment in the Northern Delta, as well as in the Cache Slough Complex. We would also like to draw a direct link to available state funding, such as Proposition 1 through the Delta Conservancy, as well as the Department of Fish and Wildlife. And then, of course, the reason we're here today is that this will also serve as the basis for the amendment of the ecosystem elements of the Delta Plan. And this is why we're really working closely with Delta Stewardship Council staff. So what are we basing the framework on? What are the central premises? What's the central premise? Which is the conservation of Delta ecosystems will benefit, again, both people and the environment. So that is, I think, the key difference from prior efforts that have been going on. So we're focusing on building community, promoting ecological function, basing it on the SFEI work and other plans, providing multiple benefits, not just looking on one side or the other. Focusing on people and the place. The Delta is a very unique and wonderful place. And increasing the efficiency of some of our processes and costs associated with this work. We only have a limited amount of money, so we have to be smart about how we're going to spend that. And, you know, funding is one of the big challenges that we hear, and especially long-term funding. So we really want to highlight the need for that into the future. And I just want to make sure that we are all on the same page about what we mean when we say Delta conservation. It is not just restoration. It is also implementing strategies and related actions for the integration of the stakeholder community in the Delta, and then also protecting certain places if they're not protected. Certainly the focus is mainly on state-owned lands or available conservation lands. But if there are willing landowners that would like to engage, we welcome that. We also want to enhance areas and, you know, certainly restore and use adaptive management in the context of the Delta ecosystems and their ecological functions, as Leticia mentioned. And again, this is to benefit human and natural communities both. So this is just a depiction of our planning context. So in the middle there is our Delta conservation framework, a long-term framework. And as I said, we're basing it on prior plans and the input from stakeholders that we're receiving. It is taking off directly from California EcoRestore, And we are really working very closely with the information that is provided in these reports that SFEI has been producing for the department and, of course, for the Delta community. And then as we would like to see the Delta Conservation Framework outcomes really include the Delta Plan Amendment for the ecosystem restoration piece, as well as tie it directly to the state funding, as I mentioned, and then for it to inform the regional conservation strategies, because that seems to be a great opportunity for this overarching high-level framework to actually get implemented. So this is just to show you a few of the main sources for the framework, Eco-Restored, the Delta Renewed report that you just heard about, the Water Action Plan, of course, the existing Delta Plan and the Delta Reform Act, the State Wildlife Action Plan, and so forth. So we have a lot of varied perspectives that we're wrapping together into this plan. In the second workshop with our stakeholders, we focused on what is it that we're going to be interested in conserving. So what are the topics of conservation? One, of course, is restoring and enhancing and protecting functional delta ecosystems. And in this piece, we're really focusing on basically what Leticia just shared with us. And then the second one is, we got the feedback from our stakeholders that this is a very important piece, of course, and it's, I don't want to say revolutionary, but it is a really wonderful step in the right direction, that we are really working hard to bring in the peace of the people that Leticia mentioned in the resilience framework, and integrating the Delta community in this context of conservation. We started coming up with overarching goals, and I'm going to share with you just the basic ideas about those. For the functional delta ecosystems, it is, of course, to reestablish resilient ecosystems in the delta and the underlying processes, and come out with interconnected mosaics of aquatic, transitional, and terrestrial habitat types, and that includes working lands, so agriculture is part of that. We want to not forget about climate adaptation, so we need to think ahead and come up with, you know, thinking about scenarios and what, how do we think things are going to evolve and change over the next 30 years or so. Biodiversity, we would like to, you know, have native dominant communities if we can, but certainly that's not always possible. Life history support for resident and migratory wildlife, including birds, and I realize that is one of the focus areas that the Delta Plan would like to include in the amendment. Improved water quality, and it, you know, the list goes on, but these are just a few that I'd like to share with you at this point. With regard to Delta community integration, we really want to, like I mentioned earlier, provide a way for Delta stakeholder communication and collaboration that is at the same level. So we would like to get the buy-in as much as we can. We want to try our best to integrate conservation with agricultural sustainability. So wildlife-friendly farming, for example, is one way to achieve that. We also want to do what we can to integrate the conservation with the flood protection goals. Obviously, there are so many levees in the Delta, and we need to think about, you know, what we can do there, and I know the council is already working on this as well. Low-impact outdoor recreation, which can provide benefits for the Delta community through tourism, so there's an economic benefit associated with that. And then, of course, public education. I think we need to take the scare factor out of conservation. That, you know, show people that it can actually benefit them in the end. And it's not just about, oh, we're going to come and take your land away, or we're doing something that's going to annoy you. So I think there's an opportunity there. And then, you know, reliable local water has been one thing that we've heard a lot about in our conversations with the stakeholders. So we need to think about local water supply and integrated water management in that context. So again, the idea is to focus on multiple benefits in our conservation endeavors as much as we can, so that, you know, we basically look at this this slide here and see these three circles, and where they overlap is where we want to end up in developing our strategies that, you know, we then propose as overarching strategies for the Delta. And again, I mentioned the regional conservation strategies. We hope that they can then take off from those and build more locally focused actions to implement them. So again, I mentioned the stakeholder engagement schedule. So we've already had two workshops. We have two more scheduled, one in later October, where we will look at the adaptive management piece, as well as sort of think about the where. So Leticia mentioned some of the opportunity areas. We want to kind of get a better sense of what can we do where, and then reiterate that in the November meeting with folks and say, so, you know, here we are. We think that these are good places. And what's already been done? Who are the players? You know, how can we move forward, and include that, and as well as positive examples of the progresses that we have already made into the framework report. We then will have a 30-day public review of the document in early 2017, and. So again, I think this is a very fast process, which hopefully is a good thing, because then we can move on to the regional strategies and other work. We have a website if you're interested in following our progress, which is on the slide here. And then I just wanted to share with you that these are so far the entities that have been engaging with us, state and federal agencies, county agencies, private residents, nonprofit organizations, consulting firms, and universities. Thank you for your attention, and I think we're ready to take some questions.
Excellent. Thank you. Thank you all.
I just want to make a quick point. Thank you all so much. Those were great presentations, and I just want to direct the council's attention to the end of the staff report, where there are a series of five questions. Which I think our speakers have already addressed to greater or lesser degree, but if there are any of these questions that you'd like to delve further into in addition to your own questions, I just want to point those out. Thank you.
Great, thank you. Very, very well done. I would summarize what I have just heard as a need to improve the land-water connection in the Delta, and to improve habitat opportunities in the Delta, which we all agree and believe that that's the right thing to do. Yesterday I mentioned that not much good happens without a champion, and we highlighted Eco Restore. I see David is here. Things are moving at a pace that we've never experienced in the Delta in terms of reclaiming that land-water connection and improving habitat. I was expecting to hear a little more about stressors and stressor control as it relates to the orphaned conservation measures. Christina, you mentioned that one of the goals is to have native dominant species, but it's not always possible. Well, currently it's not possible because we have clams competing in the food web. We have predator fish eating the species that we're trying to save. We've got pyrethroids and ammonium in the water. We've got invasive aquatic weeds. When will you get to addressing those kind, controlling or attempting to control those kinds of things as part of the recommendations for Delta Plan amendments?
More specific focus areas are basically nested within these overarching strategies. And so when you're saying we would like to you know, reduce the negative effect of invasive species in the Delta areas, then we would think about, well, you know, again, at the more local level, which ones are the stresses there? And, I mean, all this work has been done. It is at our fingertips. And just to be clear, the framework isn't going to be 1,000 pages long. It's hopefully only 50 to maybe 70. And so a lot of what the framework will be doing is pointing to the knowledge base that we already have acquired and then work through overarching strategies of, so these are the things that we really need to do. Whether or not this makes sense over in the South Delta, you know, is something that you in the South Delta need to figure out, or we need to talk to the entities that are actually involved in implementing any type of actions. So it is a nested approach that we're doing. And again, yeah, it could be, you know, we could make another 1,000-page document, but I don't think that that's where we are headed at this moment. Did you want to add to that?
Yeah, exactly. Our need for a high-level, broad planning document, providing, setting the stage essentially for these more regional strategies where the locals and the people working in the individual regions will pull from that and decide what the important issues are there and how they envision, with the broad strategies that we identify, implementing that in their area.
Okay. Other questions or comments? Susan?
I think this is really exciting. And I agree with you, Dr. Sloop, that the report from SFEI and this report is an opportunity to marry what both reports would envision and like to happen in the Delta. I'm wondering, when you say integration on slide 9, Dr. Sloop, does that mean that you're also going to bring in, for example, upstream actions that would impede implementation of the suggested actions in the framework?
Thank you. That's a really good point. Yes, with our conversations with the stakeholders, we have been very we have gotten very clear feedback that we can't think of the Delta in isolation. And so, yes, upstream issues with regard to the various strategies that we're suggesting will be part of the discussion and have been, you know, mentioned. That's our approach. I mean, It's always hard. I'm an ecologist, and I am a very high level landscape thinker, and I really appreciate how everything is always connected, and so we really can't forget that. Whether or not, you know, to what extent we can actually provide specifics will be challenging. I mean, we do have to actually get together in workshop 3 and think about, you know, what is our main planning region. But still have that caveat, okay, well, there are other plans that have been thinking about these other things, inputs and also outputs into the bay. So we are definitely including that.
Mr. Chairman?
Yes, Frank?
Do you feel you have sufficient buy-in from the residents and from the communities? I notice there's some counties aren't listed here. Would be pretty key, I would think, in your efforts. This should not be a top down. It's hard not to be, but it shouldn't be, because you're a big thinker. You said you're at 30,000 feet. That's not the way this is going to get done. You know that, I'm sure. Do you have enough buy-in from the local communities?
Well, we are starting the process, and I think what we're doing is really trying to invite people. It's going to take more than the time we have at hand right now with this planning process to actually gain their trust. But from the feedback that we have gotten so far, and Brooke, you can follow up if you like on that, is that folks are positively surprised, maybe that's the right word, that we are reaching out in the level that we're doing. We're conducting our meetings in the Delta. We're working with the Delta Protection Commission as far as we can to, you know, get folks to the table, as well as the Delta Conservancy. We have one wonderful Delta South Delta resident at the table that, you know, tells us what we might want to do to reach out to others. The reason I'm mentioning the Delta Protection Commission is because they're working very closely on what is it that the Delta community really wants. And I mentioned earlier the idea of, you know, bringing the conservation idea to people and making it less scary. Looking at the work that they've been doing, I think we've identified some specific opportunities that we might be able to engage further with them. Because once people see, oh, well, maybe this isn't going to hurt me, or at least it's going to be neutral, then maybe I don't have to oppose it. And so this is our approach at this point. Whether or not we're going to get everybody behind us in the next 3 months, I doubt it. But again, the opportunity provides itself to continue the conversation, hopefully, through these more regional strategies as we move forward with implementation, because that's where the department really wants to go with this. We want to see, like EcoRestore, we want to see things, actions on the ground.
And if I can just add to that quickly, the way that we've structured the workshops is we have small breakout groups, so we give everybody an opportunity to look at portions of the document as they're being developed. Everybody gets a chance to voice their opinions and concerns and criticisms about it, and then we've actually been able to integrate those and feed them back to the group before the next workshop. So they're getting to really see the document being developed as it goes, and then at the end they'll have another chance with a 30-day public review. So we're trying as best we can with the resources that we have available in the timeline to get that feedback and integrate it in, not just come to them with a fully baked document and ask for their feedback. So far it's been working.
Great. Asia?
Just to Judge Damerow's point on the outreach, and I know that time is of the essence and resources are scarce. I fully recognize that. Just the presentations that you all made this morning were just phenomenal and excellent for anyone that is not scientifically inclined to clearly understand. And I'd highly recommend just spending a little time just doing outreach to the schools within the area, because I know that when kids are excited about science, their parents get excited and pay attention. And I think it'd be something that is worth doing. And even to Dr. Granier's point about her son just having a clear understanding of what the differences with the ecosystem transformations over time. And I think that kids definitely need to be indoctrinated to what the issues are now, because this is their future. This is what they're going to have to deal with. And I think it's such an important topic. And I know that they would be able to take it and become passionate about it and hopefully ignite their parents to become advocates, or at least to get involved and to understand what's going on and what the what's really at stake here. So I just commend you all on your work. I was just really excited and just very honored to see just a panel of strong women and doctors that are just doing great things. So I just commend you all. And I'm sorry, but I'm a feminist. Thank you.
Good. Mary and then Patrick.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. The sisterhood is strong, right, Asia?
Yeah. All right. That's right, Mary.
As exemplified by our panel. Quick question on slide 9. And to inform, I don't know if you know, but I sit in this role as chair of the Delta Protection Commission. I also sit on the Board of Supervisors in Contra Costa County. So I greatly appreciate the reference from Judge Damerow, Councilmember Damerow, on the local voice and input, and I'm gonna hit on that a little bit. On slide 9, when you talk about low impact outdoor recreation, I'm curious what your definition is of low impact outdoor recreation under Delta community integration.
Yes, thank you for that. One of the wonderful and very interesting parts of this experience for us has been how we present certain things and then we get them mirrored back. And you know, I originally had just put outdoor recreation, and then there were strong voices that meant, well, you know, we have to make sure that it doesn't hurt the wildlife. So this is why I now, you know, kind of summarized here low impact to mean, well, you know, let's not do things, certain things everywhere, you know, like people everywhere in the Delta may not be a good idea either, you know, if we wanted to also protect wildlife. But so, you know, it's the idea of balance in the approach of recreation.
Okay. I think maybe it needs to be further defined, but I'll take that for now. On your stakeholder engagement, I appreciate the reference that the public workshops are taking place in the Delta. Can you tell me a little bit more about where they've taken place and where you expect the next two?
Yeah, so all of this is on our website. The first one was held at the Delta Conservancy in West Sacramento, mm-hmm. and it quickly became obvious that it was too small. So the next three workshops are going to be at the Gene Harvey Senior Center. Mm-hmm. In Walnut Grove, and the schedule and the location is on our website, so you can always find it there.
Do you do any, instead of people going to find you, do you do any outreach, for instance, in my county and my colleagues with the other Delta counties? I'm sure would be happy to send out an informational flyer to our email databases and make them aware in community meetings.
Yes,
if you can share that with me, I'd be happy to share it with my colleagues.
Yeah, thank you. I was checking in with Eric Vink about that mm-hmm. point and timing around that, and he said, well, let's wait until after workshop three. I think we're then ready to move out, because then we'll have, I guess, more of the initial planning to share with the counties. And we've like I mentioned earlier, we've had county folks involved, representatives of the county coalition, and they have been very instrumental in our planning so far, and they've been at the table from the beginning. So,
well, and that leads to one of my next questions through the chair is on the counties that are listed. I see Sacramento, San Joaquin, Solano. I don't see Contra Costa, and I'm trying to figure out why.
Good question. This is, you know,
something
we
need
to work on.
Yeah, Costa, right?
These are the listed entities that have shown up so far to the workshops.
So invites are going out to county staff.
We have Delta Counties Coalition and represented on our interagency planning
and
team.
And who's that?
Natasha Drain.
Okay, Natasha's there.
Yeah. So and also Douglas Brown has been helping, you know, voice the concerns mm-hmm. that he sees from the locals in that process. So we've been relying on them, but we are always happy to come and give presentations. And we have a flyer, we have a mm-hmm. website. So if you think of people that we should be working with, please tell us, and okay. we'd be happy to do that. Not a problem.
Absolutely. And then two last questions, Mr. Chairman. One to suggest, and you're already talking with Eric Vink, it would be great to get a presentation before the Delta Protection Commission, one of our upcoming meetings when timing is appropriate. Certainly would be a great forum for all of you. Letitia, your presentation was out of the park. And then lastly, Mr. Chairman, my question would be, what guidance will these documents provide in possibly easing or streamlining the permit process? How can we use it for an advantage? You know, the public doesn't understand that not only do developers need to go get permits for projects, but agencies need to go get permits to do environmental projects. And the time constraints and the cost associated with that is extremely immense. So maybe if you can touch about possibly how we can improve that permit environmental process and get win-wins on both sides, time savings, economic savings, et cetera.
Yeah, that's a great comment, and that's one that comes up universally in every conversation we have about the framework. So thank you for bringing it up again. And it's definitely one of those challenges that we're going to be highlighting in the document, and to the extent that we can come up with strategies to address it, we will. We're not going to solve the permitting problem in the next 3 months when we write this document. I can't say that, but we will definitely be pointing to it, and our intention is to have this as a conversation starter. To really think about that, think about the hurdles, both in timing and cost, that permitting currently poses for implementing conservation in the Delta. It's an important thing to think about. And so this document is a conversation starter, right? It's the Water Action Plan for Conservation in the Delta. It points out the really big things that everyone knows are important. And that's one of our next steps. Yeah.
Mr. Chairman.
Thank you.
Just following up on what Mary said, I would not rely on my invitations to somebody. I would be proactive. I would not publish a document, frankly, unless you had every county in the Delta on it, every county. And I think you just have to be more aggressive. and you're thinking about that. I mean, it's so far so good, but it's not going to work if all the counties aren't buying into this thing.
Yeah, that's a good comment, and we're still halfway through the workshop, so we will do a little bit more aggressive outreach to the other counties to bring them in before the document goes out for public review, which is the next step in soliciting and incorporating stakeholder feedback. So thank you.
Patrick.
Dr. Jacobs, how's EcoRestore doing, and how will this report and document look compared to the progress on EcoRestore?
So EcoRestore right now is separate, but this is intended to be the long-term continuation of EcoRestore.
Right.
EcoRestore, as you know, is a set three-year time frame. Mm-hmm. It's moving forward very quickly and very aggressively with the projects included there. We've been working with Resources Agency all along. They've been involved in the planning of the framework, looking ahead to this being the long-term continuation, right? Looking to that need to pick up what was left on the table when the pivot happened over the long term, away from the BDCP.
Have you looked at the projects in EcoRestore against the template that you're developing here?
Yeah, so that's a great point, and that's looking ahead very nicely to workshop three, where we ask that question, where? What's the planning area that we're thinking about? What are the regional areas? And so one of the maps that we're going to be showing will include public lands, because the framework is targeting public lands, and also all of the EcoRestore projects. So they're part of that context for what is being done currently in the Delta and where we're going to be looking in the future.
Thanks. Jessica?
Oh, I'll defer, I'm sorry, to Council Member
Ken, and then Jessica.
No, this was really helpful, and as the new guy here, it really, yesterday we heard about the smelt resiliency plan, and kind of hearing your big picture view on this really helps a lot. So I've got just a few questions that kind of get at, you know, the way I'm trying to look at things through the co-equal goals, and maybe Dr. Grenier, the example you gave on marsh restoration and the relationship size of marsh and black rail, I mean, is that, you know, I've kind of heard a lot of conflicting views on how you know, the certainty of you know, taking these types of actions and the connection to species recovery. And I don't know, maybe marshes and black rail, you know, black rail or all over the country, I think, and you know, is that more sort of accepted that you've got this formulaic relationship? But when we talk about something like smelt and maybe doing, you know, restoration work to protect smelt against predators, there seems to be, hey, we think it'll work, but we're not sure. So it kind of gets to maybe, you know, what is the state of the science on that?
Yeah, that's a good question, and I get that one a lot. I think there's a great certainty that at the level that we're approaching this sort of broad holistic document, we'll get great lift in these ecological functions. We would get marsh wildlife back, we would get riparian wildlife back, we'd get a better food web. I don't have any doubt about that based on sort of global science and restoration. It's not a species-specific plan. Actually, I feel quite sure we'd get the marsh species back. Birds are easier to study, you know, they're like out in the daytime, you can catch them. Fish are harder, they're underwater, we know less about them. But I think one of the biggest challenges with species like smelt is, and I've tried to highlight this in my presentation, like imagine you took my house and turned it into a train station, and then you studied me and you're like, oh, she's not doing very well, she can't find enough to eat, like there's nowhere to rest, like what's wrong with her? You know, well maybe I'll build a little bench over here and we'll try to add a little food over there and maybe get rid of some of these like non-native people that are walking through her train station. That's not enough. You know, what you need to do is build me a little apartment so that I have a place to live in the train station. And so I think that gets back to your invasive species question too. We can't expect wetland species to live in lakes, which is kind of what we're doing to them. So if we build more wetlands, we can't get rid of the lakes that we have. Maybe to some degree we can. But if we build more native type habitats, then I think we don't really know what smelt will do, right? We haven't been able to study them in the place that they were adapted to. And so I think that's why it's so hard for the smelt biology to be really clear, because we're studying a species in a place it doesn't belong. So in some ways, at that species-specific level, sort of trying to fix the landscape and the processes that build and maintain the landscape, will be experimental in the sense that then we'll have to see. Oh, so one of our, so to get back to your other, one of your other invasive species questions, the food web, so the clams are eating a lot of phytoplankton, it's and zooplankton's causing problems for native fish. Well, one of our side projects that's come out of this work is looking at thinking about the food web and the complexity of it. And when you've lost 99% of your wetlands, that's a huge amount of food. So we don't really know how that food could have supported smelt if it were here. So we're gonna build a few wetlands, see if that does start to support the fish. And in so it, there's ways of sort of competing with what the non-native species are doing by creative native ecosystems and places in that train station for our native species to go live. But we'll have to monitor them, we'll have to learn from it. My hunch is that just based on, you know, basic biology, you make a place that a species is adapted to, it's going to do better than if it's living in a totally different ecosystem. So I can guarantee that we would get ecosystem and ecological service lift across the board, but that species-specific stuff I think would help also, but we're going to have to focus more attention on it. But so that's different than saying marshes are going to save smelt. Does that make sense?
Oh, yeah. No, okay. And by the way, you do great at analogies. Because when you talked about low-impact recreation, I thought about yoga classes on levees. but, you know, I decided not to blurt that out then.
You changed your mind.
You know, I guess my point on the coequal goals, and this gets to kind of my next question, is that other side of the coequal goal, water supply reliability, is very species specific, and I think the pivot away from BDCP, we had a better idea because we kind of knew the standard of BDCP was species recovery, and all these things were going to happen, and maybe they were kind of very aggressive, but there was a connection. I think the pivot sort of disconnected those two things, at least in, you know, what the standard is. So when you're planning on, you know, your framework is planning towards some kind of standard where, you know, is it, and we have to be species specific because that's what, you know, water supply is going to be based on, and that's avoidance of jeopardy. So how does, you know, and again, I'll take the out that I'm new to the council, but how does Eco Restore, your framework, how does the standard that you're planning to for species or for conservation, how does that all interconnect? Because that's sort of the easy on BDCP, if it all worked, you know, mission accomplished, coequal goals accomplished.
Yeah, so that's a really good question as well, and that's another one we get fairly frequently. And the answer is the framework that we're developing is really focused on conservation in the Delta. So it's really focused on CMs 2 through 22. The flow issue is going to be taken up by other science-based efforts, so permitting for CM 1 in the Delta and also the Water Board revision for the Water Quality Control Plan. So those are separate. We're not tackling flows in the framework,
right,
specifically.
No, I understand that.
Yeah.
But it all works together. And this gets to my final comment, which kind of goes back to the panel we had here yesterday, because they were talking about restoration efforts in the smelt resiliency strategy. And your colleague, Carl Wilcox, was here. And we had some discussion with him because Carl kept talking about outflow. And we're talking about these other actions. And then finally, I think it may have been Cliff, Dr. Dom, that kind of said, gee, you know, is it you just want water in the system? And I think Carl said, yeah, well, we're more comfortable when there's water in the system. And I was kind of, well, water in the system and restoration, that sort of, you know, that really has an effect on water supply. Are we trying to restore via restoration so that there's less emphasis on outflow? And I think that's kind of the challenge we're going to face as you pull all this stuff together. Yeah, that's kind of what I took out of all of your comments. So I think in terms of what an amendment would look like to the plan on restoration, I know I would be looking at how does this relate to getting to a point where, you know, we can say, gee, we are balancing these two goals and we're achieving both of them.
I'm surprised that none of the panelists said, Ken, that's your job.
Yeah.
And it is. And they're working to help us prepare these orphan conservation measures in a manner that then we can deliberate and implement into, knit them into the Delta plan with the sole purpose of achieving the Coequal goals. So the work they're doing is preparatory for us, and that's why I asked the question I did, because the more they can do, the better it will be for us to deal with some of these other things like stressors.
Mr. Chairman, just one more quick comment or question or highlight is a couple of us had the privilege, at least it was for me, to visit the Black Hole Riparian Habitat Restoration Project, privately managed near Lodi this week, and it was an interesting model, very thorough presentation provided. And David, Mr. Okita, I'm sure you've seen it or aware of it, and if not, I just wanted to make sure in the dialogue here about important restoration projects, timelines. This one's 25 years in the making, which is a long time. I don't have any idea on expense, but I know the Dutch Slough project is very long time and very expensive. But for models to look at and outreach to local stakeholders, this might be something since you're in the middle of your process to either have an aware of if you didn't already, but also be mindful of in your study efforts.
Yes, thank you very much for pointing that out, because we are actually looking for really good examples to include into the framework document. But you also brought up a really good point about the longevity. And, you know, part of the reason why this framework is long-term is that these types of restoration projects get implemented, but then they actually evolve over a quite long time. I used to work in the Bay with Dr. Greenier together on tidal marsh restoration there. And, you know, I mean, it's not just a couple of years. It's not just 5 years. It's not just 25 years. It's sometimes almost 100 years or even more, depending on, you know, what you're trying to restore. So I think we need to make that message clear as well. And unfortunately, in the political reality, that's not always a thing to embrace. But thank you for the point.
Mary and Randy and I saw the project together, but one of the things that I came away with was that scale matters, and that's 750 acres, and the notion that little, really tiny restoration projects may have trouble with long-term success. Will you address those issues or evaluate that in your? I know it's a big, you know, scale that you're
yes.
looking at, but
it has to do with connectivity, and it goes back to the landscape scale. And you know, sometimes smaller areas are still valuable. Mm-hmm. Of course, you know, it all, as Letitia pointed out, it depends on your goals for the specific area. And, you know, if it's an educational goal and, you know, if we can take kids out there, then, yeah, by all means. Whether or not it will, you know, fit into the bigger puzzle piece of, you know, the large functional improvement that we're after, that is another question. And I think it comes back to the decisions that we have to make, and they're not always easy with regard to spending the money where. And I guess as a general rule, as Dr. Greenier pointed out, you know, it's better to try to do a larger scale than smaller scale. But again, in my past experience in the Bay, we actually funded a project there that was small, very expensive, but it had that added benefit of being close to the public and getting people out there, and that whole learning and education piece was invaluable. So I hope that answers your question.
May I add to that? I think, to me, a really key difference is if you have a shared vision, then all the little projects add up to something. And I think we've seen examples of where, without that shared vision, they're kind of random, and there's no value added to all the parts. That also, in my mind, gets back to the permitting problem. So in the Bay, as Christina said, we've been thinking, you know, we've been working on tidal marsh restoration a long time. They're starting to talk about a regional general permit for marshes, which would be huge for accelerating marsh restoration. That's been pushed by climate change and a lot of the science that's pointed out the problem. So I think this shared vision that's coming is the first step in saying to the agencies and the small restoration projects, here's the plan. Now we can start to tackle the plan as a team instead of going in a bunch of different directions. And maybe that's a way to get EPA and the Water Board on board with some faster permitting approaches.
In longer duration permits, I know you need to check in with permits, but instead of an annual permit, maybe it's a 5-year permit or a 5 to 7 year permit, but these annual permits, invasive aquatic weeds, for instance, Division of Boating and Waterways used to need to get them every year. Now they've extended that period of time. It's up for review next year, but it's just, it adds to the cost, adds to the inaction, and it adds to ineffective land use management and environmental protection. So just to emphasize, the length of duration of the permits is also extremely helpful and valuable.
Jessica, isn't the Delta Conservancy doing the work of the puzzle of where reclamation, or not reclamation, but habitat projects are being developed to get at what Dr. Grenier indicated that?
Well, I'll defer to Jessica Davenport, but yes, they're particularly focused on the North Delta, the Cache Slough. They've got a planning process that they've recently launched there, and maybe JD can talk a little bit more about it.
Sure. So the Conservancy Board recently voted to fund the Cache Slough complex planning effort, which is partnership with several local government agencies, and they're going to create a baseline study of various aspects of that area, not just the habitat, but also the status of flood protection in the area, the water supply, the waters that's taken out of that area, and then that baseline. This is a phase one, and they're hoping to get approval for a phase two, which will start to bring all that information together to help those agencies and the public decide, together with support from SFEI as well, where the priority areas are to restore and how to do tidal marsh restoration and other kinds of restoration and conservation in that area while incorporating those other needs such as ag preservation, flood protection, and the local water supply.
So what I was trying to remember was whether they were doing what I thought Dr. Grenier was saying, is that so if you have a plan or a template or something to work against, then the varying projects of little or large size can fit, or proposals have to speak to whether they contribute to the overall plan or whether they are in danger of being a one-off that doesn't matter. My question is, where does the monitoring function lie? Is it with us? Is it with the Conservancy? Is it with Fish and Wildlife?
Oh, you're looking at me. Okay. I was just asking Campbell Ingram this the other day. And at this point, there's no keeper of the big plan. I think the Delta Conservation Framework puts it out there. It becomes, you know, regulatory through the Delta Plan Amendment. But, you know, what he said to me was he's going to filter it through funding. So when people come to look for Prop 1 funding through the Conservancy, he's going to be looking for whether they understand this big picture. Now, he'll be pointing them toward it, but do you understand the big picture? Do you understand these approaches to restoration? So at this point, that's what there is. I'd say that's exactly the same approach in the Bay Area restoration world. So I think with the multiple jurisdictions, we don't have that. Maybe you guys can do it.
Well, so like with the Delta levy investment work that we're doing and we'll get back to soon, won't we, Jessica? One of the issues is what kind of environmental improvements ought to occur when the state spends money on a levy project, because mostly it's just flood protection, and the other goal, the ecosystem goal, is kind of orphaned in most of the funding. But the point is often made by reclamation districts and their engineers that not every project makes sense to do some ecosystem work. but that it ought to be programmed at a higher level. And DWR makes that point too. So would your work be what DWR, or for that matter, in our work, indicate ought to be looked at to see where a project ought to go, so that if you're restoring a levee or improving it, and there should be some environmental component to it, maybe it doesn't go there, but where it might go would be indicated by your plan?
Yeah, I think that's a good question. So we've had DWR at the table. They've been helping develop the framework alongside us from the start, so they're definitely engaged and interested in that. And something else that you mentioned is also something that's come up in the workshops that we're trying to wrap our minds around right now, but the idea that maybe not every component of a levee project would have a habitat component, but it's appropriate in some places, and so thinking about that. And so that's one of the things we're trying to incorporate into the framework at a very high level for guidance. And then these regional plans can actually take a closer look at, in that area, what are the areas we think it's appropriate to integrate the two, or what are the areas where maybe it isn't?
So here's what I'd like to see. I'd like to see you be fairly specific and not very vague about that, because what happens is that money goes out to fix levees because flood protection is virtually the sole priority as a historical fact. And consequently, adding on for environmental or habitat work is viewed as superfluous and actually competition for limited funds.
Exactly.
To do more work. And if the state's policy is the coequal goals, and the work that you're doing contributes mightily to that, we should make sure that we all integrate both the flood protection with the environmental improvements.
Yeah, no, I agree, and that mirrors the comments that we've had in the workshops, and also the competition of funds, right? There are limited funds. We have to do the flood protection, and so having this as a guidance document for solicitations in the future, potentially to help augment that. Yeah.
I can add a few words to that. Thank you, Patrick, for bringing that up. You've been really supportive of the work we've done to develop that report, Improving Habitats Along Delta Levees, where we identified this need to have a landscape scale framework for environmental improvements associated with levee projects. And what we heard through our advisory committee, which included DWR, is we want lines on a map to show where should we put these environmental improvements so they really will benefit the target species. And so we're actually in the process of developing a task order, working collaboratively with CDFW and DWR to try to get there. And that's something that will be ongoing over the next few months.
I have
a couple
of comments, but I'll keep them brief and maybe just more phrase them as things to consider rather than asking for an in-depth response. But I wanted to echo Ken's comments about the coequal goals. I mean, that's the lens through which the council views everything. It's the state's policy. And just to be maybe more explicit in the framework about the connection between the state's water supply reliability. I noticed that you mentioned local water supplies and water quality, but you can't do large-scale restoration in the Delta without thinking about the implications for water supply reliability for the state, just like you can't make changes to the state's water supply system without thinking about the vice versa implications. I also have some questions about the regional strategies. I think they can be quick questions. Just who will be developing the regional strategies, and is that funding coming from Prop 1, or has it not yet been identified? And then also I wanted to encourage you to think about research needs as they come up through this process. Concurrently, our staff through the Delta Science Program is looking at the science action agenda, which will be developed over the next year and will build on the interim science action agenda in place now. So we really need to think about being specific about research needs that you identify through your process and how they can be plugged in to the multi-agency work of the science action agenda to make sure that stuff gets done. And then also maybe you can mention in response about the regional strategies whether it would be expected those would include performance measures, because that's something that we also spend a lot of time thinking about here and would be helpful to us in our ecosystem amendment.
Okay, well, thank you for pointing to the regional strategies again. The idea, as far as the framework is concerned, is to basically set them up or tee them up after we have identified the opportunity regions in our next workshop. So what we're trying to do is suggest, you know, based on all the information that we have from prior efforts, the Delta Plan has pointed out some areas that are opportunities for restoration. The BDCP has done the same. The Delta Conservancy has done the same. And certain areas are already being worked on with regard to project implementation through EcoRestore or other Prop 1 funding. All of these things we will be considering in a mapping context. Who the entities are, well, I would hope that it'll sort of be the continuation after the framework of the entities that have been working together. We know, you know, through the grapevine that there are, you know, certain efforts already underway. Jessica mentioned the cash slough complex work that the Delta Conservancy is focusing on. We have heard rumors about other entities in the northeastern delta coming together and wanting to get serious about that. So in a way, we hope that the framework work will help that, and we can directly bring in the context of the funding need and tie it to Prop 1 funding wherever appropriate. So we're trying to, like I said, integrate this and nest this so that the framework can become the overarching umbrella, and then, you know, the regional strategies can get into more of the details at the regional level. So that's one of the answers.
Jessica, great panel. It has gone longer than I had anticipated. I'm thrilled with the level of interest and the quality of inquiries, the work that has been done thus far. This is all good. I hope that we have impressed upon you that we are depending upon you for guidance, and that we will take your work and move it forward. You've heard some specific requests and asks for consideration, so we look forward to working with you. And Leticia, the work that SFEI has done on the three reports is phenomenal. I can't wait to get my hands on the final report. One question. On the last picture that you showed, I always take it upon myself as a challenge to see if I can figure out where that picture was taken. Is that an artistic rendering of a riparian forest, or was that actually a picture taken in the Delta?
We took it upon ourselves as a challenge to create an image that looked real,
okay,
but you couldn't tell where it was. It's a picture of the San Joaquin that we have altered to protect people who own parcels, right? So it doesn't look, it is really a picture of the San Joaquin that we've jumbled and added restoration to.
Mm-hmm. Okay, good. I'm not losing my edge. Okay, with that, thank you very much. We're going to take a 10-minute break. We'll reconvene at 10:40. So in reconvene now, welcome back. To wrap up file item 15, Pat, I didn't see any requests for public comment. Were there any? Okay, very good. Then that wraps up file item 15. On now to file item 16. update on Delta Plan amendment for conveyance storage and operations.
Thank you. We have a lot going on at the Delta Stewardship Council. And this is one of several ongoing Delta Plan amendments that we're pursuing. And my role here is just to kind of provide a memory refresh and background as to why we're talking about this item here today. So as was discussed, and is even the basis for a lot of the work that we just heard about, similarly, the decision to move away from an NCCP by the Brown administration in April of 2015 essentially triggered a commitment that we had embedded in our 2013 Delta Plan, that if an NCCP were not to move forward in the Delta, that we would be revisiting the issues of conveyance, storage, and operations as they pertain to the coequal goals. Specifically, the Delta Reform Act asks us in our Delta Plan to promote options for new and improved infrastructure relating to the water conveyance in the Delta, storage systems, and for the operations of both to achieve the coequal goals. So after that announcement was made by the administration, we began almost immediately to convene a series of expert panels to advise the council on what kind of action it should take to promote options. And then that fall, staff developed and then the council shaped and ultimately adopted 19 principles to guide the amendment. Those principles are included as an attachment in your packet. And then in March, we came before you and presented kind of a general work plan and what I'd call a conveyance, storage, and operations landscape analysis. That is, what are other agencies doing, planning, and what kind of regulatory authorities might they have that relate to conveyance, storage, and operations? So then, at that meeting, you asked us to go a step further and look at the landscape through the lens of our 19 principles in order to start identifying opportunities for council influence and where coordination and integration might be needed and other takeaways. You also asked for a better understanding of the types of specific projects that we know are on the horizon that would be relevant. And so those questions that you teed up in March bring us to today. And additionally, since that time, as you might remember, we've brought on MWH as our consultant, and their expertise complements our team. And from there, I'll turn it over to our deputy, Cassandra Enos.
Thank you. Good morning, Chair Fiorini and council members. Once again, I apologize for being between you and your lunch, and not only am I between you and your lunch, I'm between you and the weekend. So, but I do think that this fits in particularly well in what we've heard so far at this meeting yesterday and today. So yesterday we heard a little bit about the Delta Smelt Resiliency Strategy, and one of the things that was brought up was using the yellow bypass to convey water to provide food production. So you think about it, that's a form of conveyance. And then earlier we heard from Dr. Ganier about, you know, conveying, moving water through the Delta and the dendritic channels, and so that's how water is conveyed through the Delta. And a little bit earlier we talked about the coequal goals. So I think that thinking about conveyance right now, this is perfect timing. So I want to introduce the members on the panel before we go too far. You know Anthony from yesterday, so he doesn't need an introduction. Further to my left is Jamil Ibrahim. He's from MWH, and he is the project manager on this task. So you'll be seeing a lot of all of us during the course of this amendment. So I do want to bring back or step back and think about what Jessica mentioned from March. As she said, there were a couple items that the council asked us to further investigate. One of those was the kinds of conveyance, storage, and operations projects that are foreseeable and that the council may seek to influence. And the other was what existing authorities are out there and how do they apply specifically to the 19 principles. And I want to direct you to your staff report. The 19 principles are attached as attachment 1 to your staff report. So Anthony and Jamil will provide sort of results of that further analysis in a moment. However, I just wanted to take a moment also to step back a little bit and see if this pops up and think about the roles or the range of roles. That the council plays now in implementing the Delta Reform Act, especially related to conveyance storage and operations. So as you can see from the figure on the screen, and it was figure in your packet on page 4, the Delta Reform Act assigns 5 roles to the council, and that's coordinate, ensure consistency, inform, comment, and ensure accountability. So right now, the DPIC coordinates with state and federal agencies to identify and prioritize goals for the Delta. Staff ensure consistency of covered actions through our certification process. And I just want to note right now, as you know, that's limited to state and local actions. However, if the federal, if we get federal approval of the Delta Plan under the Coastal Zone Management Act, that would be extended to federal actions as well, which is particularly pertains to this amendment because, as you know, the federal agencies play a large role in the Delta in both regulating and operating conveyance and storage. So staff review and comment on activities of interest in the Delta, as well as activities outside of the Delta that may have a significant impact on the Delta. So for related to conveyance storage and operations right now, staff are reviewing and developing comments on the California Water Commission's proposed regulations for Prop 1 funding of storage, for the DWR water supply contract extension draft environmental impact report, and on the State Water Resource Control Board Phase 1 substitute environmental document. Related to INFORM, the science program informs as it works closely with the science community to identify, prioritize, and fund research. It conducts synthesis of best available science, reviews and provides feedback on adaptive management proposals, and organizes independent peer review panels. So yesterday you heard Dr. Dom talk a little bit about the work that they've been doing on estimating net delta outflow, and that particularly that's an example of how that could inform and be related to storage, conveyance storage and operations. The council also ensures accountability by tracking performance measures through online tools such as Delta View, which we presented last month, and through our annual progress report. And also, staff comments on other items that are relevant to the Delta. So staff has thought about and considered how the council may use the various roles that it has now to influence future conveyance, storage, and operations. For example, the council could consider refining or adopting new policies related to certification of consistency, such as requiring new conveyance and storage projects submit operation strategies for a variety of hydrological scenarios. Alternatively, the council could make targeted recommendations to permitting or funding agencies. The council's Delta Science Program could, where appropriate, convene science panels to inform development of the scientific scenarios to be used to establish those operation strategies for conveyance and storage projects. And as you know, the Delta Reform Act gives the council authority to request reports from state, federal, and local governmental agencies on issues related to implementation of the Delta Plan. The council could consider the types and frequency of reports that might be useful in tracking accountability and meeting specified objectives related to conveyance, storage, and operations. So these are just a few examples of the roles that the council could play in future conveyance, storage, and operations amendments. And I just wanted to pause here and see if you have any questions.
Questions of Cassandra? No, it's a good overview.
Okay, thank you. So now I'm going to turn it over to Anthony to talk about the types of foreseeable projects and existing authorities.
Good morning, council members and Chair Fiorini. As Cassandra mentioned, in March, the council asked what existing authorities apply to conveyance storage and operation, and how do they apply to the 19 principles. Council staff and our consultants have done some analysis of existing state and federal agency authorities, regulations, and or other controls and oversight actions which assist ensuring that new or improved conveyance storage and their operation will achieve the coequal goals guided through the 19 principles. There are some clear existing authorities, such as the State Water Resources Control Board influences conveyance and operations through water rights and water quality criteria. The California Department of Fish and Wildlife influences operations and the protection of fish species through the Fish and Game Code 1602 for lake and stream bed alteration permitting, as well as through the California Endangered Species Act codes 2050 through 2069. The analysis looked at authorities that relate to planning, funding, implementing, and operating of future conveyance and storage projects, which would allow the council to better understand the context as we are developing an amendment. Better understanding of the planning and regulatory landscape can allow the council to influence in areas that the state or federal agencies potentially do not have existing authorities, or more so, do not exercise their authorities or to an extent that would best serve the coequal goals. In the analysis, staff and our consultant have identified areas where minimum authority or activities exist to further the 19 principles, areas where substantial authorities and guidance exist to further the 19 principles, and areas where there are existing authorities or approaches, but they appear to not only partially address the 19 principles. Within the context of existing authorities, here are a few examples of opportunities of the type of influence and potential future projects that council may want to develop a Delta Plan amendment regarding conveyance, storage, and operations. In regards to Delta Conveyance Principles 1 through 5, particularly Principles 2 through 4 relate to increasing the resiliency of the water system with respect to climate change and ecosystem needs, as well as provide flexibility and integration to adapt to a variety of changing conditions. There are large implementing agencies such as DWR and Reclamation, which have policies and guidelines that require consideration of climate change in planning activities. Additionally, CEQA requires effects analysis related to climate change, but there are no apparent provisions that would require achievement of these principles for new conveyance systems. Note, the Delta Plan includes a regulatory policy that would require that a significant conveyance project must detail and fund an adaptive management plan so the proposed project would ensure adaptation to changing conditions to meet the project objectives. Here, the council may consider how proposed projects would achieve the implementation of their climate change planning. In regards to water storage principles 6 through 10, these principles seek water storage projects that are part of a system which supports a comprehensive approach to water cycle management while providing cost-effective, immediate, and enduring ecosystem and water supply benefits. In general, the California Water Commission's Proposition 1 Water Storage Investment Program addresses the principles in its proposed funding regulations. The proposed regulations would require applicants to assess the net physical and economic public and non-public benefits proposed by potential funding projects. Relative to the Council's work, the Water Commission proposes to evaluate projects on several metrics, such as relative environmental value, magnitude of water system improvements, implementation risk, and project resiliency. The Water Commission proposed regulations are a good step to require the type of information that a proposed project may also further Council's storage principles, but it only applies to those projects proponents ultimately consider for Prop 1 funding. The Council may want to consider how these assessments, where appropriate, could be applied to future non-Proposition 1 projects, as well as extend to potential conveyance projects. Water System Operation Principles 11 through 19 provide guidance for a more efficient reoperation that seeks a multi-year planning horizon of a conjunctive water system to provide net benefits to the ecosystem. There are implementing agencies such as DWR and Reclamation, as well as regulatory agencies such as the Water Board, Department of Fish and Wildlife, Natural National Marine Fisheries Services and U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service, which have the authority to operate the water delivery system to protect the resources via the Clean Water Act and the Endangered Species Act. Additionally, the Delta Plan includes water quality recommendations 1 through 3 to protect beneficial uses, to identify covered action impacts, and recommend the Water Board to evaluate, where appropriate, propose special water supply, water quality protections for priority habitat restoration areas. Additionally, the Endangered Species Act requires avoidance and mitigation to protect species or avoid jeopardy, but the 19 principles seek for the enhancement of the ecosystem through improvements to the operation of the system. So here's an opportunity where the council may consider what role it would like to play in achieving the objective for ecosystem enhancement beyond ESA through an amendment related to the operation of the system. So as you're reflecting on the type of influence a Delta Plan amendment may have, here are some potential types of projects that may be affected or influenced. Future conveyance projects are well-known California Water Fix or North Bay Aqueduct, but there are other projects such as in-Delta intertide projects or Trans Valley and other regional conveyance projects which may have impacts to the Delta and its tributaries. Future types of water storage projects are well known, such as CalFed, but others could be conjunctive use projects and water bank projects which may have impact to the Delta and its tributaries. So now I turn it back to Cassandra.
I just want to pause and see if you have any questions on specific kinds of projects or specific projects.
Jessica?
Well, we mentioned Cross Valley Conveyance, which when I first heard about it, I thought I had some ideas about, but then when we met the other day with the MWH, they had some more specific examples, which I think would be helpful for the council to hear about. So maybe Jamil could address some of those examples.
Sure. Thank you, Jessica. Council members, it's a pleasure to be in front of you here, and I have to just say that we're happy to be of support to you in developing your high priority amendments to the Delta Plan, so thank you for the opportunity. So Jessica alluded to the Cross Valley Conveyance, and many of you are familiar with longstanding plans and ideas to try to move more water across the valley and improve the overall integration of the Central Valley Project and the State Water Project. There are other opportunities to actually improve regional water supply reliability through improved interconnections across various water districts and water agencies. So these may include projects that would actually improve connectivity of the CVP's Fryant Division to the California Aqueduct, as an example, or improve regional conveyance facilities within the San Joaquin Valley and even the Sacramento Valley that allow the regional water entities to be able to manage their water resources more effectively across those agencies in a more integrated fashion that would support conjunctive management and climate change resiliency. So I don't know, Jessica, if that's the type of detail that you're looking for, or okay.
Yeah, I think, you know, we talk about conveyance storage and operations, and we have a tendency to just think about the big conveyance project, the big storage projects, but really the council has the opportunity to opine on much more than that, that cumulatively affect the Delta.
Council members, any questions or response thus far? Cassandra?
Well, that's all that we had to present today. I think that I just wanted to spend a couple minutes on next steps and to let you know where we're going. So what we intend to do is put together a discussion draft of the amendment and bring that to the council for consideration, and at the same time also present kind of a plan for public engagement and involvement in developing a review and future amendment language.
Okay.
So do you have any questions about that?
Patrick? No questions about that, but you have a comment.
I'd be guided by you, Randy, as to how we're going to organize our thinking about this. It strikes me that the 19 principles that we developed with regard to conveyance are too brief, comprehensive, but too brief to lay out a number of expectations that the council would have for any conveyance project. So you've spoken about focusing on outcomes, and I would agree with that approach. It seems if that's the course we pursue, and I know that's subject to this discussion, but if that's the one that we pursue, I would want us, and with staff's help, to think about how some of the things that we mean implicitly by, like the first five principles, we might say more clearly. So in other words, if you're going to have a conveyance project, I'm talking now, I guess, about a big conveyance project, that that we say something about the survivability of fish or the you know, enhancement of the environment with some specificity, the repelling of salinity or the adequacy of water for farming in the delta. Not so specific that it ends up catching us in a process of trying to set a performance standard that are numbers for all time in the future, but that it speaks to, well, what are the values in the delta, and they include the fisheries as well as terrestrial species and birds and also the farming and if there's a project minimizing disruption to the community, so that our conveyance outcomes that we would hope would add more specificity, so that, and also says something about adaptive management that we would expect that any proposal would have a adaptive management plan that is properly funded, that is long-term, that is measured against scientifically developed standards, that we say those words. So if we're going to take the higher view of outcomes, we do it with a little more precision.
Good. I would agree with that. This doesn't look kind of bare bones to me.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
That's what staff is seeking as our guidance. Others? Susan?
So to continue the train of thought that Senator Johnson was explaining, I anticipate and would expect that the staff draft would translate the principles into rough screening criteria, and that would get to the specificity that he's speaking of. So, for example, under Delta Conveyance Principles 1 through 5 here, number 1, that is the principle, but what are the screening criteria we're going to use to make this principle actionable? So, for example, Jamil Ibrahim talked about efficiency and integration that would result in encouraging conjunctive management and increase efficiency of the system, and not just for conveyance, but the overall operation of the system. And I would be looking for screening criteria that gets at that concept. So I'm excited to see the staff draft.
Ken?
You know, maybe my question is more clarifying, because I'm wondering, you know, just thinking, and maybe I'm too far ahead thinking of, how we make a consistency determination if we're looking at storage above or below the delta. You know, is any single project going to come in and have those aspects to it, or are these, you know, and when would we see projects that are outside the delta, you know, come before the council for consistency? I think, Jamil, the examples you gave about the, you know, lack of a better word, the laterals that you know, those would be proposed by individual districts or and we would be able to kind of say, all right, is this, you know, is this consistent with the plan? But it seemed, I'm not sure how the storage element, other than encouraging it, or would we be looking at how are you proposing to operate, you know, conveyance? Are you maximizing storage? Do you actually have storage capacity to put that water into? That's kind of where I'm, you know, taking a step back and wondering how all that fits together. What, you know, because it is, I think, and I think people on the outside also wonder, okay, how do these things that are outside the delta that we're looking to accomplish, how are we going to evaluate that? When are we going to evaluate it? Those types of things.
Yeah, that's a really good question. As you probably know, you know, covered actions have to be wholly or in part in the delta. And so if for Prop 1 funding over under the California Water Commission, they do have to show that it has a benefit to the delta. So one of the things we've been thinking about is projects that receive Prop 1 funding would likely be covered actions. Of course, that all depends on the final project description, whether or not it's a covered action, but that's something that would be logical.
In your reports, you identified pieces, you identified components, you identified some history. Let me see if I can offer some guidance as to how to organize the next step. Number one, the coequal goals are our umbrella. That's where everything begins from there. In terms of storage, conveyance, and the operations of both, there are three distinct regions. There's the delta, the legal delta, there's the watershed, and there's the export area. Not every solution is going to cover all three. Some will. Some will be specific to just one of those particular regions that falls under our umbrella of coequal goals. So what I would like to see you do is to take a look at the coequal goals through the lens of the delta proper, or the legal delta, the watershed, the export areas, and apply the principles to those. You may look at a principle and say, well, that really doesn't apply to the watershed. Fine. What does it apply to? And kind of break it down into segments. I believe very strongly that our highest and best use will be to provide prescriptions for outcomes. A number of the desired outcomes that are specified in our principles are pretty evident to all. There's not much argument that eliminating reverse flows in Old Middle River, there's no argument that that's not a good thing to do. As one example, entrainment of fish in at the pumps, there's pretty universal belief that's not a good thing to do. And then when you've developed outcomes, suggested outcomes that are derived from the principles, then seek from those pieces that you identified examples. Examples of conveyance, examples of conjunctive use storage, examples of groundwater overdraft replenishment, examples of water quality actions in the watershed, and bring us back a suite of recommendations that touch on all of those key areas. I don't expect that you're gonna, you know, cover everything, and that's the beauty of the public process that we have here. But we need a starting point. You saw from the presentation today, there really isn't a lot to react to, so you're not going to get a lot.
Or there's too much to react to.
Yeah, it is. Yeah, that's a very good point. This is a pretty overwhelming task. And I've been wrestling with it for quite a while, and that's why I've distilled it down to start with the coequal goals, identify the legal delta, the watershed, and the export areas as the three areas that are interrelated but sometimes distinct, and prescribe outcomes that we want for conveyance, storage, and the operations of both. Yes.
So along the lines of examples, it would be great when you have those examples, if you could offer a theoretical observation of how they might synchronize and work together and integrate to achieve the coequal goals.
Conveyance, storage, and operation to the larger picture as well. I mean, I think that's what Pat was kind of getting at. I mean, that's a very good approach. Don't get me wrong. It just strikes me that we ought to be a little more. I mean, now that a lot of things have been considered, lots of things have been proposed, some things have been discarded, we should maybe take a look at a broader picture as well, laterally as opposed to longitudinally. Is that, do you understand what I'm saying? And I think that's what Pat was, but you can reiterate what you had in mind. My impression was to relate this to the larger picture.
Mm-hmm.
This is not an engineer's diagram. This is something much more, I think, lofty than that. That's what I got from Pat. I think it would be helpful. But I don't mean to, I think you're correct in what you're saying. I have no problem with that.
I think you're both saying that, yeah.
As an example, the technical document that the Water Commission has prepared in support of storage is lengthy. It's 400 plus pages. It really does a marvelous job of prescribing a method for evaluating the benefits of a particular project by taking the non-project option versus the project option, so you can see the relative difference in the benefits derived. And then the application process really forces the applicants to describe how their project is going to integrate with the rest of the system. That's something that we should derive. That's one of the pieces, Anthony, that you identified, and that's what I mean when I say you should then, you know, based on our principles and whatever it is that we prescribe, you should use examples such as the kinds of guidelines that have been prescribed for Prop 1 storage projects, and then as you indicated, those don't necessarily have to be limited to Prop 1 storage projects. It could be a part of the Delta plan because there's some very, very good processes set up in the work that the Water Commission has is in the middle of right now.
Yeah, those technical reference documents really expand to like that long view horizon where they look at the 2030, 2070 for the proposed projects and their effects and their proposed benefits. So, yeah, they did an excellent job.
Mary?
Mr. Chairman, I know there's a lot of options out there within the stakeholder world of conveyance, storage, et cetera. But we need to be looking at a reasonable range of alternatives. We don't need to be looking at all of them. I would suggest we need to be looking at a reasonable range, and there, the challenge then becomes what's reasonable. But I think we can find a way to limit the heavy lift that is obviously before us. I would also suggest that we use best available science. We have an excellent infrastructure with scientists within the Stewardship Council and the ISB. We need to use them. And lastly, I agree with the chairman about ensuring consistency with the coequal goals. That should be our primary focus, our primary responsibility, and as Randy said, it is our umbrella that we operate under. It's also the foundation upon which we stand, and it's integral to our efforts in this regard. Thank you.
Yeah, Ken?
Got me thinking some more, and Frank, your comments about having something loftier. I'm getting a better sense of how we're defining, you know, ecosystem restoration in just terms of, you know, what we're doing and what the outcomes. But, you know, water supply reliability, have we defined that? Or is it, you know, how do we measure that something that's proposed is contributing to water supply reliability? How broad is that definition? Is the in-delta conveyance by, you know, maybe adding interconnections and redundancy and that kind of thing, that's part of the definition of reliability? And it seems like, it's almost like the coequal goals are up here, and this is there's a physical way, this physical improvement in the system is going to show it either it contributes or to both of those elements. And I think it's now I'm kind of struggling with, okay, how do we measure what it's contributing? And you know, how do we know when we've got there? Or maybe it's because I don't, you know, the plan has enough specifics, but we didn't. Life was easier with the BDCP because it was all there. And I think Randy, your example on sort of what the Water Commission's doing when you had the no project alternative, I guess, yeah, I keep thinking in terms of CEQA. It's very easy to go, okay, well, here's why it's a better world if we do something versus nothing. But, you know, it's maybe the metrics of what these projects are going to do, so then we can say, yeah, it's consistent with the plan, but it also contributes to, you know, ecosystem restoration and however we're going to define water supply reliability, which is a really tough thing to do. And maybe that kind of...
The good news is we did, in the Delta plan, define right. Water supply reliability, and it's actually attached as to the principles as a footnote.
Oh, okay.
But it's a good reminder for us to focus on that definition. We put a lot of thought into it, it does get into some specifics. So that's an important lens to keep on as we consider how to operationalize the principles.
The water supply reliability is a challenge because it's two component, it's two perspectives. Is it what the system can provide, or is it what the state and federal projects have committed? And that's the needle that we are all trying to thread. Is it what's available versus what's been committed?
I guess a document to keep in mind as you're preparing this is the Delta Challenges Report. Ken reminds me that, you know, we think about why are we doing these things? Maybe it just serves as the basis of a preamble, but I think there's some elements in the Delta Challenges report that could be drawn upon in support of some of the options that we will want to provide.
And we're approaching this as an integrated amendment. Clearly, we've got science program staff and planning staff working together, and you may recall that when we had the discussion about the principles, we brought to you kind of a updated summary of best available science since 2013 that's been informing us all along, and Mary's suggestion to think about using the ISB is absolutely spot on, and I think that's the right way to go once we have something that's in shape to bring to their attention so that they can help us evaluate whether it truly is based on the science. And, you know, I think Anthony did a good job and Cassandra did a good job of articulating in the staff report, but it's easy to lose track of that our current set of regulations will apply to, for example, WaterFix. or to a North Bay Aqueduct type of project, and potentially to a large storage project, depending on the way it's defined and whether it meets the definition of a covered action. And so we have requirements for demonstrating reduced reliance, which is part of our water supply reliability definition. We have a requirement for adaptive management plans, and actually that's one of the regulations in our Delta plan that's arguably having the most effect and is changing the way that people are doing projects in the Delta, not just on conveyance, storage, and operations. And we have a requirement for people to demonstrate that their decisions are based on best available science, and it's a pretty rigorous standard that we spent a lot of time developing in 2013 and describing, and that our staff spend a lot of time consulting with other agencies on their projects and evaluating and offering guidance on. So we're not starting from scratch, but we need to think about what kind of options the council wants to promote in this amendment.
And I do just want to mention that, you know, along with, you know, as part of this amendment, we'll be developing new performance measures, and that's something that we definitely will be depending on the ISB and the science program to help us develop. So,
Have you received adequate input from the council?
Well, I'm not going to cut you off, but what I'm hearing is that you're ready for us to just take a long, hard look at how do we operationalize these principles, what might it look like, and to develop a list of specific recommendations that we can bring back to you that you can start to to tackle and unpack and refine, and we can go from there. Yeah. It's not an easy job because so many people are operating in this world, but we have a unique policy and integration role and to focus on the long term and to focus on the bigger picture. So figuring out how this amendment can satisfy the Reform Act and add value, I think is going to be an important endeavor.
Yeah, adding value is a key component to this. The principles are good. We spent a lot of time and got a lot of good help to prepare those. So now identifying where the added value occurs with our work is I think the important next step. All right. We'll look forward to something to react to. Anything else? Do we have any public comment on this matter? Do we have any public comment on anything in general? Hearing none, we have reached the end of the meeting. We are now adjourned. Thank you very much.
So, Randy, adjourned with the speed that the umpires ducked out of the St. Louis Cardinal game last night.
I didn't hear that.
Yeah, so because it matters to the Giants, right? So the Reds are playing, and the Cardinals, Yadier Molina.